Hi everyone, here's a new video with exercises on the Laplace transform. Today we'll solve some exercises together and hopefully this will help you understand this important concept better. I'm Gio, I'm an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona, and on this channel I upload theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems, so this is actually the right channel for you if you want to learn the basics very quickly. Let's get started with today's exercises. First exercise, which is exercise number 4, gives us a transfer function h of s, which is 1 over s minus 1 times s plus 3, okay? So we should sketch all the possible regions of convergence, and for each case we should reason whether the impulse response that corresponds to the system is right-sided, left-sided, or bilateral, and whether the system is causal and stable. So let's draw the poles of the system, okay? As you can see, there's a pole in plus 1 and a pole in minus 3, okay? So I drew them there. And we know that the region of convergence is always delimited by the poles. So there are actually three options. One is that the region of convergence is for real part of S smaller than minus 3. Another one is for real part of S between minus 3 and plus 1. And the last option is original convergence to the right of plus 1, okay? So we're going to study these three cases one by one, and we'll see that the corresponding impulse response is really different. Its behavior changes. Let's start with the green case. So we'll take the case real part of s larger than 1. What happens in this case? Okay, obviously we know because of the properties of the Laplace transform that the corresponding impulse response will be right-sided, okay? That's because the region of convergence is a right half plane. Also, the system will be causal for the same reason. And the system will not be stable because the imaginary axis j omega is not contained in the region of convergence. We can do some more calculations to actually verify and validate this and derive explicitly the impulse response h of t. So here what I'm doing is I'm decomposing h of s in a partial fraction expansion, and as usual I need to determine the coefficients a and b. So I come up with a system of two equations and two unknowns, and through very simple algebra manipulations I get that a is minus 1 over 4 and b is 1 over 4. I just replace these values in my expression, and now I have to anti-transform the two terms separately. For that, I need to know their respective regions of convergence, right? So how to do that? With some simple reasoning, we can figure out easily what these regions of convergence are. So let's draw the regions of convergence for the whole h of s, for the first term and for the second term, okay? The first term, I mean the one with a pole in plus 1, and the second term, I mean the one with a pole in minus 3, okay? So let's start with the overall h of s. We have assumed that real part of s is larger than 1. So here you see marked in green the region of convergence. Then obviously the first term, the one with a pole in plus 1, needs to have regional convergence to the right of plus 1, right? Because otherwise the overall regional convergence would not be right-sided. And what about the other term? Well, it needs to have also a right-sided regional convergence. It's the only option. So as you can see, this is the only combination of regions of convergence that gives me a region of convergence, real part of s larger than 1. Okay, now that I have this information, I just write it down and I'm able to calculate the anti-transform of the first term and the second respectively. And as you can see, they are given by right-sided exponentials, right? So the overall h of t can be written as the sum of those, and therefore I can verify that yes, it is right-sided. I have u of t and u of t, okay? It is causal for the same reason, but it's not stable. Why it's not stable? Well, the first term, the one I have circled in green, is the one that causes instability, okay? Because this term diverges, you know? For positive t's, it grows to infinity, so h of t is not absolutely integrable. Good stuff. So now we can move on, and we can consider the second case. The second case for the regional convergence, in this case I consider the red one. So real part of s smaller than minus 3. What happens in this case? So I know that because the regional convergence is a left half plane, then the impulse response will be left-sided. The system will not be causal, obviously, for the same reason. And it will not be stable because even in this case, the imaginary axis is not contained in the regional convergence. So let's do some more calculations to explicitly get h of t and also verify what we just said. So here I'm marking again the regional convergence of h of s, and now I'm going to draw the regional convergence of the first and second term of the partial fraction expansion respectively. So the first term has to be left-sided and the second term has to be also left-sided. This is the only combination that will give me a left half plane region of convergence for h of s. So now that I know these regions of convergence, I anti-transform both of them and I get two left-sided signals, and h of t is the sum of those two, okay? So once again, I have validated that h of t is left-sided in this case. It's not causal because I have u of minus t, which is non-causal. And it's also not stable. And the term I circled in dotted red is the culprit of the instability because basically it grows to infinity for negative time. So that makes the h of t not absolutely integrable. Right on. So now we're going to move to the third and final case, the third and final option, which I marked in blue. In this case, we consider that the real part of s is between minus 3 and 1, okay? So in this case, because the regional convergence is a vertical strip, then the impulse response is going to be bilateral, meaning double-sided. The system will not be causal. And it will be stable because, as you can see on the top right, the imaginary axis is contained in the regional convergence. So now let's keep going and let's derive the regions of convergence for each of the two terms of the partial fraction expansion. So as you can see, the first one is to be a left half plane and the second one is to be a right half plane in this case. It's the only combination that yields a vertical strip for h of s, okay? Let's write those down and let's anti-transform, okay? So now in this case, the first term will give me a left-sided signal and the second term will give me a right-sided signal. So when I put them together, here's what I get for h of t at the bottom in blue. Again, it's bilateral as I was conjecturing because there's a term in u of minus t and another one in u of t, so it extends to minus to plus infinity. It's not causal because of the presence of u of minus t. And it is stable in this case. Both terms are absolutely integrable. So the conjectures are confirmed. Now let's move on to exercise number 5. Here I simply have to determine the magnitude of the Fourier transform given h of s, okay? So I know that the Fourier transform given the Laplace transform is obtained by simply replacing s with j omega. So if I just write h of j omega like this, look what I get. Well, this is easy. I get a fraction of polynomials in j omega, and I see that the real part is the same, up and down, and the imaginary part is changes the sign, okay? So basically, I have the numerator and denominator are complex polynomials and conjugate. They have the same real part and opposite imaginary part. That means they will have the same magnitude, so the magnitude of their ratio will be 1 for every omega. If you do not trust this, you can actually do the calculations explicitly. So you calculate explicitly the magnitude of this fraction. How do you do that? Well, for the numerator, square root of the square of the real part, which I have written, plus the square of the imaginary part, which is omega square. And the same for the denominator, square of the real part plus square of the imaginary part. And the result is 1 as we expected. So one more exercise for today. So I'm given a system which is described by a certain differential equation, and I want to determine the step response of this system. Cool. So let's work in the Laplace domain and let's see what the step response is, how to calculate that. Well, first of all, I need to determine the response h of s of the system. So in order to do that, I transform left and right hand side of my equation. Okay, I remember their differentiation in time domain corresponds to a product by the variable s. Okay, so here's what I obtain: s y of s plus 5 y of s equal 2 x of s. And then my h of s simply is given by the ratio between y and x. So it's simply 2 over s plus 5. That's great. Now, what is the region of convergence? Well, there's only one pole in minus 5, so there's two options for the regional convergence, but the exercise is telling me that the system is causal and stable. So that means that the regional convergence needs to be a right half plane because it's causal. And also because in this case, it includes the imaginary axis j omega, so it's stable. Right. So now, if I want to determine the step response s of t, I can go through the Laplace transform first. So because the step response is the convolution between a step u of t and the impulse response, well, the Fourier, the Laplace transform will be given by the product of the respective Laplace transforms. Okay, that's because of the convolution property. So I have one already, h of s, I have just calculated it. So I need to determine the other one, the Laplace transform of u of t, the Heaviside function. So let's do that. It's a very simple integral. And the result of this, if you just do the very simple calculations, is 1 of s. And this converges only when the real part of s is positive. Otherwise, the integral does not converge. So having found that, I can replace it in my expression. So the Laplace transform of my step response will be given by 2 over s times s plus 5, okay? The s at the denominator is introduced because it's the Laplace transform of the step function, okay? What about the region of convergence? Well, it has to be real part of s larger than 0. At the beginning, h of s had a region of convergence that was wider. It extended from minus 5 to plus infinity, okay? But now I have introduced another pole due to the step function. So the region of convergence has shrunk. And now it's to the right, okay? Good. So now I decompose this into partial fractions, and so I need to determine the coefficients a and b as usual. So I get the usual system of two equations in two unknowns, and that is pretty easy. It gives me that a is 2 over 5 and b is minus 2 over 5. So I just replace that. So now let's stop for a second. What we have is an expression for the Laplace transform of s of t, okay? I'm looking for s of t, so I will have to anti-transform that. But now it's in partial fraction expansions, so it's going to be quite easy. Let's do that one by one. So I have two terms. One term is 1 over s, and the other term is minus 1 over s plus 5. To anti-transform them, I need to know their respective regions of convergence, okay? But I can easily conjecture that because I know the region of convergence of their sum, okay? So one of them has a pole in 0, the other has a pole in minus 5. Both of them need to have regions of convergence as right half planes. It's the only way to produce the region of convergence real parts of s larger than 0, okay? So given this combination, now I can anti-transform them. 1 over s gives me simply u of t. Well, I knew this. And the other term gives me minus e to minus 5 t u of t. Pretty simple as well. So that means that s of t, the step response I was looking for, will be given by 2 over 5, which is a pre-multiplication factor that I have up there, u of t, which is a common factor, times 1 minus e to minus 5t. So let's take note of that, and let's represent it to see what it looks like, okay? So I'm just going to draw it. So here's what it looks like. It's something that for t going to infinity converges to 2 over 5. And it gets closer and closer to that value, right? And then the important point is how fast that happens. So basically, for a value t equal 1/5, okay, it has reached basically 1 minus e to minus 1 of the final value, okay? So that's why I have marked it there, because that gives me information on how fast this convergence occurs. This is an important property of my system. That's great. But now look, that I could have found out the step response also by working in the time domain. So this is what I would like to show you just to conclude. So in the time domain, what I should do is from h of s, which I have calculated, I do the anti-transform and I obtain the impulse response, okay, h of t. So if you anti-transform that, it's pretty simple. You know everything, you know h of s, you know the region of convergence. So h of t will be 2 e to minus 5 t u of t. We should be able to do this by now. Now, s of t will be given as definition by u of t convolution h of t. So u of t convolution 2 e to minus 5 t u of t. So I can just simply calculate this convolution through the integral, okay? We know what the definition of convolution is. So in this case, I take the 2 outside and I get the integral of e to minus 5 tau u of tau, which is h of tau, basically, times u of t minus tau d tau, okay? So how to proceed? I can simplify this integral as usual because I have step functions. So I notice that the function u of t minus tau is non-zero only when t minus tau is positive, which means when tau is smaller than t. Why am I looking at the values of tau? Because my integral is in d tau. So I need to look at the values of tau, okay? So I know that, and I simplify my integral. Now the integral runs from minus infinity to t. Cool. There's another step function, u of tau. That's obviously non-zero when tau is positive. So now I have two cases, okay? If t is positive, and if t is negative, so it's two different cases. When t is negative, the integral is zero, because the function u of tau is non-zero only for positive tau, but the integral is running between minus infinity and t for a negative t. That means that the integral is zero. In the other case, the integral is non-zero, though. The integral becomes the integral between zero and t of e to minus 5 tau d tau. So in that case, I can actually keep going with the calculations. And the result I obtain is 2 over 5, 1 minus e to minus 5t. So now I just put this together, okay? I consider that there are two cases. That's the result I found when t is positive, but when t is negative, the result is 0. So how to write that in a compact way? Well, simply using u of t. So as you can see, I have obtained exactly the same result as by working in the Laplace domain. So as promised, today we solve more exercises on the Laplace transform to keep practicing together. And please keep watching the other exercise and theory videos, and do subscribe to this channel to know when I upload a new video. So see you in the next class.